Hello wonderful person, this is Anton, and in this video we're going to be briefly talking about cosmic rays, and specifically about the kind of radiation you actually experience up there in the skies. Now, you might be wondering what's with the background here. Well, this is actually one of the reasons for the title of this video. I'm going to be away starting today for a couple of weeks, and I'm actually going to be going to a relatively remote location in Eastern Europe to finish some of my mom's affairs. Some of you may already know my mom actually passed away about 4 years ago, and this is one of the reasons I became so active on YouTube. It was actually a kind of way for me to cope with, well, really with the fact that my mom died. But I'm finally ready to kind of face it, and I decided to visit the location where she's buried, and I also decided to kind of finish all of the things here legally just to put a closure to it. But honestly, I would rather not share too much. What I wanted to share though is my trip to this location, because I spent half a day on a plane, and what else am I gonna do on a plane? I decided to turn it into a kind of an experiment. I basically took a couple of radiation detectors with me. One of them was this really cheap Chinese one that you're going to see in a few seconds, that is going to tell me the actual background radiation of the location I'm in. But the other one was from Korea that attaches to a phone or an iPad and can actually measure radiation using an app that they made. So one of them can actually measure things really accurately, specifically this one. It measures gamma radiation, it measures X-ray radiation, and also beta radiation. The other one was more of a simple tool that only does, I believe, gamma and X-ray. So first of all, I'm going to explain to you how cosmic radiation works. And second of all, I'm also going to give you an idea of why you really shouldn't worry too much about radiation in general. Oh, and by the way, right now in the place I'm in, this is what I'm getting. 12 to 14 microsievert per hour, which is actually a typical normal background radiation for any place. Now, where is this really coming from though? It's actually coming from space. It's actually cosmic rays that do reach the surface of our planet. Let me explain this in a little bit more detail and also mention what's going to be happening for the next 2 weeks. So, the first 7 videos you're going to see is actually going to be a playthrough of a video game that I reviewed on a channel a couple of months ago. And I really wanted to play it, and I really wanted to record it. And so I finally did and decided to put it as a kind of a playthrough that some of you may enjoy, but some of you may probably not find it fun at all because it's a game. Anyway, that's going to be the first replacement for my absence. And the second replacement is actually going to be a compilation of older videos that you may have not seen actually. And I decided to put them by theme into long videos that you can actually watch and maybe rewatch if you've already seen some of them in the next 2 weeks or so. So that's going to be the replacement for when I'm gone, and once I'm back, I'm going to obviously resume my regular scheduling and begin with some of the more recent events that happened either recently or will happen in the next 2 weeks. On that note, so let's start with the little cosmic radiation experiment that I devised while on the airplane. And the experiment starts right here in Seoul Airport with this interesting robotic arm making my coffee. Now, this is kind of cool, but should you be worried if you're a barista? Are you going to be replaced by these things? How's the coffee? Is it going to be good? Well, I was actually interested to find out because it was super cheap. And turns out, after my initial attempts, yeah, you shouldn't really be worried. The coffee was, I would describe it as, I would never try it again. Anyway, so this is the airport, and this is the X-ray machine that scanned my luggage right there. That's the jump you see on the screen. But the average radiation here was about 0.23 microsievert per hour, which is a little bit higher than my home. So I decided to move around to measure things, nothing special. Then I got into the airplane and started ascending. And to no surprise, the actual measurements started increasing quite a lot. As you'll see in a few seconds, it actually jumped very, very quickly, very, very dramatically. This is only after a few minutes of flight. And it was going up and up and up, just like the airplane. Get it? Symbolic. Anyway, at 26,000 feet, or about 8 kilometers in the air, the measurements were about, you're about to see, they were approximately 0.9 to maybe 100 microsievert per hour. This is about 6 to 7 times higher than my apartment. But as we ascended a little bit higher, the values actually started to increase quite dramatically. As a matter of fact, this is where the values were. This is the average in the last 10 minutes, and this is the current value. And also, if you were to compare it to my iPad values, they're actually a little bit, well, not a little bit, dramatically lower, because this thing right here doesn't measure the beta radiation. It only measures gamma and X-rays. But anyway, so the values here started to jump. And this is, I think, at the altitude that you're going to see in a few seconds of about 10 kilometers.
34,000 feet or 10,400 meters. So basically that's kind of how high it got, but this wasn't the top altitude. As a matter of fact, these values are about to change quite a lot, and just a little bit of altitude are going to increase these values dramatically. So at 39,000 feet, almost 12 kilometers, the values then jumped again. And here we were at basically 2.3 to 2.5 microsievert per hour. And this wasn't even the highest value yet. I'm going to show you the highest value after I explain to you what's happening. So what you're observing are the actions of the cosmic rays. They're not technically rays, they're actually particles, usually protons moving super, super fast with a lot of energy and a lot of mass. We believe most of them are produced either in supernova or centers of galaxies, such as, for example, supermassive black holes. But we've also detected them coming out of our own sun, specifically the solar corona, where the temperatures are about 2 million degrees, and normally during flare activities. So whenever there's a solar flare, usually you would expect a lot of cosmic rays as well. Some of these particles carry up to 40 million times more energy than we were able to produce inside the CERN particle collider. And basically that's a lot of energy, and this is why these particles and these cosmic rays are very interesting in research, but can also be dangerous, because imagine this particle knocking out a lot of molecules inside your DNA and then basically turning you into a mutant. So that's why they're actually a little bit dangerous, but not dangerous enough to be worried about unless you go to space, the moon, or Mars. Originally, these were actually discovered about 100 years ago by Theodore Wolff, who used Eiffel Tower in Paris to measure the discrepancies in radiation. Eventually, another person, Victor Hess, was able to confirm their existence using a balloon, and he ended up winning the Nobel Prize in 1930s. And depending on what kind of energy they carry, you can identify three types of cosmic rays. The first type is the galactic cosmic rays, usually coming from supernova. The second type is the extragalactic cosmic rays, usually these are the most powerful, and then there is the least energetic type, the solar type, coming from our own sun. And although it's very unlikely that you're going to get hit by the cosmic ray itself, what you usually experience and what I'm actually measuring are the secondary particles that are produced by the cosmic rays due to them hitting the atmosphere and then generating a cascade of various reactions. Basically, when a cosmic ray hits an oxygen or a nitrogen molecule, they produce secondary particles. And these often are called air showers because they kind of look like this. They turn into many, many particles and subatomic particles that basically then hit the surface of the planet or obviously my radiation counter that I have on the airplane. And so when I'm detecting all of this radiation, this background radiation, this is basically what I'm measuring. I'm measuring the effects of cosmic rays on our atmosphere that then produce secondary particles. And interestingly, because there is so much interaction in the upper atmosphere, many molecules end up changing completely into their isotopes. So the super famous carbon-14 is usually produced by cosmic rays, and a lot of the upper atmosphere actually has approximately 80 tons of carbon-14 at all times. And so when this carbon-14 is then integrated into someone's body, for example, when they die, hundreds of years later, you can use the ratio of carbon-14 and carbon-12 to figure out how old they are, or basically how old the body is. There's a lot of other interesting stuff produced by these cosmic rays, but we're not going to cover it in this video. Now, normally, a person living at a sea level will experience some cosmic radiation, but the majority of radiation that you get is from things like air, which is usually due to an isotope known as radon, which is quite radioactive, that you actually inhale without knowing. But that's another story for another day. There's also radiation coming from your food, from bananas, from nuts, from anything that has an isotope of potassium. Bananas are actually quite radioactive, so if you eat too much, you might be in danger. But don't panic just yet, because we might be able to cover this in another video as well. But a person that flies a lot, specifically someone like a pilot or a flight attendant, might be overexposed to cosmic radiation, not to food, not to air. As a matter of fact, some of the highest radiation you can receive is from what's known as a polar route. For example, a flight from Tokyo to New York flying through the North Pole will actually fly near magnetic poles, which usually have a dramatically higher radiation than even I received on my flight. So a person flying these routes for about a year, specifically, let's say a pilot, will actually experience about 9,000 microsievert per year. That's a lot of microsievert. That's about 9 times higher than what you actually have right now coming out of Fukushima reactor. But that's still about 10 times lower than what the residents of Chernobyl received back in 1986 when the Chernobyl reactor exploded. And just to give you a comparison, that's still about 90 times lower than a typical chest x-ray, which is about 100 microsievert. And on my flight, I think I received about 40 microsievert, or about half a chest x-ray. But had I stayed at home, I would have received about maybe 3 microsievert per day. And so going back to my detection on the airplane, this is how high it got. It got to about 4 microsievert per hour. This is at a relatively high altitude, over 12 kilometers in the air. And what's really unusual here is that every single kilometer, or basically every 3,000 feet, the values basically doubled. And that's really, really crazy. The higher you go, the more radiation you're going to receive. And then for the rest of the flight, this is what I was experiencing. I checked this every few hours and it stayed around the same value. And as you can see, without the beta radiation, this is where my values were. So a significant number here is actually from the beta particles. That's usually really, really highly charged electrons. And anyway, so that's the end of my experiment, and this is what I learned on my flight.
And on that note, thank you so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed this video, and I really, really hope that you'll enjoy some of the videos I post in the next few weeks. But if not, well, in 2 weeks I'll be back, and the videos that I usually make will be back as well. Thank you so much for all your patience, and thank you for all your support. I'm really sorry I kind of disappeared like that for 2 weeks, but listen, everybody needs a break once in a while, and in my case, it's more of a closure than a break, because it was actually on my heart for a while, and I really needed to do this. All this legal stuff, when, you know, someone dies, you actually have to do a lot of stuff, and I've been waiting for 4 years to finish it, and I finally am going to do it. Anyway, thank you, I'll see you guys soon. Space out, and as always, bye-bye.